Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Good morning. I hope you've had a good few days. My name's Richard Banks. I work in a team upstairs called Human Experience and Design. So you probably got a sense of kind of how the lab here is structured. You know, there's five different teams basically here. And the way I always describe it is that four of them are doing kind of deep computer science related work, so tend to be filled with computer science PhDs. And then Human Experience and Design is the group that's more focused on HCI. So we're kind of more of a multidisciplinary group, and a kind of a mix of designers, of social scientists, and developers. So my plan today with the talk was basically to just talk from the perspective of a designer. So in this kind of mix of people here, I'm one of the designers. I've been at Microsoft for 20 years in October, which is always a dreadful thing to say. And I spent about 10 years in Redmond on product development. So I worked on Windows, I worked on Office for a while, I worked on MSN for a while. And then I moved into research nearly a decade ago. So I've got experience both on the product development side and then the last 10 years in research. So I thought it'd be interesting to talk about the work we've done in HXD, which has mostly been HCI orientated. We build a lot of stuff, we deploy a lot of stuff, we do a lot of field research, a lot of ethnographic work, as well as engineering work. I thought it'd be useful to kind of talk maybe from the perspective of the kinds of things we design and the role of the designer in the team. So and I kind of wanted to get a sense of the audience. How many of you are doing PhDs that kind of relate to HCI? Okay, and then how many are doing, are those people all also doing social science, or is there a separate set doing social science that they would consider not HCI? One, oh, very good, excellent, two, okay, fine. And the rest of you, I assume, are doing PhDs that are kind of more technically orientated. How many of you have worked with designers before? Okay, so a few of you. So hopefully you'll get a sense from the talk. I mean, I think this is kind of an interesting area for design. Design's kind of, from a research perspective, I think design is an emergent discipline, and the idea of kind of research through design or design research is relatively speaking a new thing. I mean, you see, particularly in the technology industry, more and more emphasis on design as a discipline, as a way of building kind of engaging experiences, high quality experiences. And it's interesting to see some of that start to move more and more into research, and hopefully the quality of engagement of design in research increasing as well. So I'll rush through a whole bunch of projects. I'll show you a bunch of stuff that we've built, and then try and leave a little bit of time for Q&A at the end to hopefully dig into a few things in a little more detail. So the way I see the role of design in the building is, particularly in Microsoft Research, is, if you like, four different facets. So I'm going to go through each of those facets, and they really describe different kinds of projects that we do. So the first is kind of pragmatic. So you can think of this as a project that has quite a highly defined context and situation, and maybe quite a highly defined set of participants. It's probably most closely aligned to what you might think of as kind of more traditional HCI-orientated research. So an example of that as a project that we've done is work we've done on AssessMS. And I think Abby Salem may have mentioned AssessMS a little in her talk earlier in the week. So this is, for those of you who didn't see that talk, this is a system that allows clinicians to assess people suffering from multiple sclerosis over time. So the goal here was to both take out some of the subjectivity of being a clinician. So clinicians at the moment basically meet with multiple sclerosis patients, get them to go through a whole series of physical motions to assess how bad their condition is, and they write down a number from 1 to 5 in that assessment. And you get a lot of variations between clinicians about exactly what that 1 to 5 means. And it's also hard for them to do kind of longitudinal observation to really get a sense of whether a condition is improving or deteriorating. So the goal of the system here was basically to introduce something using Connect that could track the motion of a multiple sclerosis patient and then provide an assessment of that patient that was consistent over all of these devices. Now, from a social science perspective, I think a lot of what's interesting here is the dynamics of introducing a piece of technology into a small space and between a relationship between clinician and patient that is quite a kind of specific one with a particular kind of set of rules around it. From the perspective of what we built, so there's a lot of moving parts here. There's technical parts, there's design parts, there's a strong context in this situation with clinicians and patients. This gives you a sense of one of the approaches we looked at with the system for assessing a patient. So this was working with the machine learning guys using basically slit scanning on video to assess both kind of horizontal and vertical motion. And then we're putting learning systems on that to have a sense of normal kind of range of motion would look like and what a range of motion would look like for somebody suffering from the condition. And this also gives you a sense. So a lot of these kind of more pragmatic orientated projects have a strong set of players in the project as well. So there's us in Microsoft Research, so this kind of multidisciplinary team of social science and design, a couple of people working in the machine learning space looking at the application of vision systems in this area. A Novartis, so their particular kind of industry partner here, a drug provider who are particularly interested in the system as a way of assessing whether their drug was providing any kind of improvement in the condition. And then a number of clinicians, three different clinics across Europe. So from a design perspective, a lot of these groups haven't really engaged with the creative side of project development. There was a tremendous amount of education that Bob Corish, the designer on this project, had to do in kind of teaching what it means to go through the design process. And the design process is basically kind of an iterative process that I suspect a lot of you kind of sort of go through, but don't necessarily think of it as a design process in day-to-day practice of conceptualizing, of sketching lots and lots of ideas, of roughly prototyping certain ideas, and then gradually narrowing down to the thing that you consider to be the best given a specific set of circumstances. So a lot of these kind of participants in a project like this don't really go through that process on a day to day, if you like. And so there can be this question at the beginning of kind of like, well, why aren't you just diving in and getting on with it when you're going through this process at the beginning of sketching, of trying to understand the situation, of trying to kind of open up the space, if you like, when a lot of people, when they come to these kinds of projects, think of the whole role of the project as being closing it down. So there's a lot of education in here, kind of teaching people the value of exploring lots of options, even those that seem strange and unusual, because they all feed into some particular direction and some particular solution. So this is the rig that we built for that. So this is very much a kind of a V1 rig, but a working prototype that we built with off-the-shelf systems that we could actually deploy with clinicians and with patients in the field. And I thought I'd show this piece of work just because it gives you kind of an idea of how kind of low-fidelity prototyping and design processes come at a project like this. So this is a very early on piece of work when Bob was exploring the idea of using audio feedback. Now, a critical part of SMS is that you've got to get your patient in a consistent position from session to session to session, so you know that there's the computational vision system is always seeing people in pretty much the same pointing in the same direction with their head pretty much the same size, the distance from the camera pretty much the same. So this idea of kind of getting your patient, first of all, in the optimum position at the optimum height so that the Connect could really see the patient properly in its cone of vision really mattered. So this is an exploration that Bob did early on. Again, no technology involved here. It's a lot of it is kind of bells and whistles. To start to kind of create an experience without any coding, no investment in technology here, just cheap and cheerful kind of one day experiment to start to get at some kind of user experience that might be provided in this project. So what he did was basically go out into the space out here, so the atrium where you've basically been having lunch in, and he mounted a camera pointing down on a long pole, marked out a little bit of space on the floor. And then him and an intern he had at the time, who's also a sound designer, basically walked around that floor as if they imagined that one of them was the clinician. So Bob was the clinician, and his intern was a patient. And so here you can start to hear the audio feedback that is starting to tell the clinician and the patient whether they're left or right of the connect. And this is the optimum point they're trying to get the person to. So you can see, you can start to hear audio feedback that says you're in the right kind of place, and then you get that ding when you're actually in the right orientation. So they basically play, they're playing around with this, but they shot the video first, and then in After Effects, a video editing program I'm sure many of you know of, they basically built this 2D representation, and the goal was that this might be some kind of abstract UI that the clinician might use, but primarily they'd use audio as a feedback mechanism. So this kind of inversion here, where you kind of you play the situation first and then you create some imaginary UI around it as a sketch, is quite common in kind of design practice. You don't always need to leap in to think, okay, how am I going to code this thing and make it a reality in order to test it? You can create the illusion and then at this stage start to really debug it a little bit and think, is this the right approach? Now in the case of the SSMS project, this isn't an approach that they particularly decided to go on. And even the idea of kind of abstract representations of people, once you start talking to patients and start to talking to clinicians, is uncomfortable for a lot of them. So the representation started to move much more human-like. But hopefully you'll get a sense for something even as kind of pragmatic and contextual as this particular project, how design sketching can start to come in to start exploring different UI and experience directions basically as cheaply as possible before you start making a real investment. Once you get committed with technology, often you get very bought into what you've built, and it's very hard to pull back out of it and then start again and point in another direction. And so holding off on that commitment a little bit and exploring things through video, through paper prototyping, through sketching, through whatever means that you have, often saves you a great deal of heartache, plus kind of opens your horizons a bit with a lot of projects later. So that's an example of a pragmatic project. Now, this piece of work was originally instigated when my grandfather passed away, and he basically left this suitcase behind of 200 physical photos. So they're beautiful objects like this, with the, you know, kind of the white border that was typical of a shot taken in the 40s, ever so slightly sepia kind of faded color. And he'd actually had metadata, if you like, put on the back by my mother. So once he got into his 70s, he started thinking a bit about who was in the photos and added this kind of, and had my mum write down who was in the shots on the back. And I really started thinking about the contrast between that and what my daughter would inherit once I passed away. And I figured out that at the rate that I'm taking digital photos at the moment, I'd probably end up, which is about 5,000 to 7,000 a year, I probably end up leaving my daughter about 200,000 digital photos. And my wife takes pretty much the same photos, you know, amount of photos a year. So there's this issue of kind of quantity, if you like, let alone kind of quality, about how somebody inheriting 200,000 digital photos, how their experience would differ from me sitting down with a suitcase of photos and being able to very easily go through 200 in an hour. So this whole project was kind of instigated by that idea, the contrast between kind of inheriting physical things versus inheriting digital things. And it was inspired a lot by field work we'd done, particularly looking at artifacts in people's lives. So we literally went into people's houses, got them to get the boxes out of their basements and their lofts that everybody has of stuff that they don't want to put around their house, but they can't bring themselves to throw away. You know, so stuff you have from your school, stuff you have from your childhood, stuff your parents have given you that they say, well, this was really important to you when you were little and you can't even remember what it was, but you feel like you can't bring yourself to throw it away. It's all that kind of material. And so we'd get people to take one object at a time out of these boxes and say, you know, well, what is this? Why do you keep it? Why can't you bring yourself to throw it away? And what do you expect to happen to this thing once you're no longer alive? So this is a typical example here of one of our participants where we said, in this box, what's the most precious thing that you've got here that you couldn't be parted with, that you wouldn't throw away? And it was this white plastic gear. So it's just kind of a really, for anybody else, it's just a totally innocuous piece of kind of broken plastic. But this was a gear that he found on the side of the road after he'd crashed his first motorbike when he was 18. And so this gear for him had this strong association with being 18, with being maybe some level of liberation, you know, being away from his family. this accident that happened. So there's a strong connection between the story and the object for him. And it's possible that if he has kids, that he will have told the story of this plastic gear and what its association was, so that when he passes away, maybe they'd get it and they'd understand what it means. But eventually the object, this piece of plastic, is going to become disconnected from the story, and it's going to kind of return to becoming a worthless piece of plastic, if you like. So we did a whole bunch of kind of fieldwork looking at a lot of issues of kind of bereavement, inheritance, and things like that. And this space, I think, is quite interesting for us, this kind of continuation of time, this issue of kind of like, is change normal? Is it every day? Are we going through more change than they were 40 years ago? What's the difference between dealing with MP3s now than dealing with CDs when they came out, or tapes when they came out? These kind of transitions through time and also into the future. What are the things we have now will last in the future? What can we hope to preserve? And so on, are generally interesting for the team. So another example of fieldwork that we did was talking to people about things they'd inherited from people who had passed away. And so one woman we talked to had inherited a whole bunch of diaries from her mother and her grandmother. And the interesting thing about the diaries was that a lot of the entries that ended up being interesting weren't the exciting events that happened in her mother and grandmother's lives. They were actually the boring things that would say things like, oh, clean the kitchen today. They were the things that really told her about what the mundane day-to-day life of her mother and grandmother was like 40 or 50 years ago. So it starts to make you think that actually things that are boring today, you know, in the future may not be so boring anymore, because they start to add additional material as you get distant from your life. You can think of it as kind of an archaeological shift, if you like, that people that you know now, your memory of a year ago is so close to you that it doesn't seem like another world. But once you start going 40 or 50 years back, these mundane everyday things start to tell you things that are kind of archaeological and typical of that time. So this is an example of a prototype we built in response to that. So this is a working system, and I think it's relatively self-explanatory. Has some text coming up, but don't think of this as a product. A lot of what we end up designing aren't really, you know, you wouldn't think, oh, Microsoft is going to release this wooden box next year for Christmas. Okay, this is a design probe that we use back in the field to get people to talk about different aspects of their lives. So in this case, talking about their relationship to social media. So a key here was that when we talk, so this woman had basically looked at these diaries, and the things she'd found that were interesting were the boring things. And it makes you think a bit of Twitter, because a lot of the stuff you end up putting on Twitter are these kind of like everyday things. And when you talk to people who tweet, often they'll say, oh, I'd never want to keep my tweets. You know, they're just saying kind of where I was, what I was doing, but it's kind of humdrum and everyday. And if somebody hasn't retweeted anything within 30 minutes of me tweeting, that's it, its value has gone. Yet these diaries really made us think, okay, that may be unfortunate, because people's willingness to get rid of their tweets because they're seen as being boring now, they may offer more long-term value down the road, and that's where this concept came from. The idea behind backup box is that this might be a piece of technology that lives in the corner of your home for 40 or 50 years. Because often people don't really reminisce about their past until they hit certain points in their lives. Often with new parents, that's a point where they started thinking about their own childhood and how they were brought up and what their experiences were like there. Often with seniors, as their physical faculties start to fail a little bit, they start to focus more on the past and reminisce and think about the lives that they'd lived. And that idea of a piece of technology that would live with you for 40 or 50 years is in itself kind of thought-provoking when it comes to just thinking about the technology. You know, the screen in this thing probably wouldn't last for 10 years, let alone 40 or 50 years, let alone the idea that Twitter will be the same. that you won't have to change the API connections in this box every 6 months because of some business decision that Twitter had made, or even that what Twitter will be. You know, if you think of the services we were even using a decade ago, how those have changed. So a lot of these, it raises a lot of kind of issues of longevity, both in the technological space as well as thinking about our relationship to this stuff and whether it'll be interesting to us in the future. So this is kind of part of a range of objects that we built in this project that we did a few years ago called Technology Heirlooms. And it's led us on to thinking about other things as well. So we're doing kind of ongoing work, thinking now more purely about the digital things in your life. So some of that work was related to physical things as well. This is starting to think a little bit about more digital things. So while we're focused on the physical artifacts in people's lives, this is starting to think about the changing nature of the digital things in our lives, where, for example, in the past, the digital things you might own might all look like this. Like icons on a desktop that you can move around, that you can copy, that are associated with certain applications, that have certain levels of mobility, but maybe are quite hard to share, to things we post online through these kinds of services, where the mobility isn't the same. You know, if I put a picture on Facebook, it's hard to move that picture to another service, or download that picture so I still own it, or download the comments that are associated with them, so I still own them. So this changing mobility, even while sharing, is this kind of amazing thing that makes it possible for lots of other people to see your content, and for you to kind of change your perception of whether you even own content that you share with others. So this is a project we were just looking at, contrasting the local file system experience and the online file system experience, if you like. If you think of tweets and Facebook posts and all the other things we're creating online as things you would want to keep through your life. So this is the classic Windows properties dialogue that you get on any file. If I put this photo up on Flickr, this is what I end up getting. Is this kind of a connected set of metadata that allows you to associate one object with another object. And suddenly I can get to all the other shots I took with this particular camera, and for example. And social stuff starts coming in here as well. So I start getting connections to other people through comments and favorites and all of these other things. So that contrast where the desktop is weirdly disconnected, it doesn't have any of this kind of connectivity, whereas online there's all this rich interconnection between different kinds of things is interesting, I think. And as a designer, that's interesting from a visual perspective as well, that we've stuck with this strong iconic representation, and yet online you have sites like Pinterest experimenting with interesting mixes between visual content and textual content. You know, why wouldn't you have a Word document that gave you a little bit more of a preview of the content and maybe mixed imagery and text in a way that Pinterest does, for example? Or rich layouts like you get on sites like Flickr and a lot of others where the images are really kind of dynamic and not so grid-like and not so iconic. So this is a bunch of prototypes we've developed as a result of just thinking about the changing nature of file systems. The first one's called Channel Hopper. And the idea of Channel Hopper is basically that playlists feel like an underexploited resource when it comes to kind of thinking about personal content. A lot of people create playlists, and every time you play a playlist, you nearly always start from the beginning. So you'd hear the same songs over and over again and become kind of very familiar with them. So we were thinking both of playlists as an unusual entity, you know. So if I create a playlist on Spotify now, I don't actually own any of the content. Then Spotify is a playlist on Spotify is my way of personalizing Spotify, even while nothing that I create in that playlist actually belongs to me. So you end up with these strange file entities, which are no longer even the stuff. They're just pointers to stuff. And even those pointers might be useful if I wanted, for example, to move to another music service. So the idea behind Channel Hopper was basically to take the idea of playlists and put them into a metaphor of radio stations. So what we've got here is a whole series of my playlists. So these are real playlists I've created over the years on iTunes that I basically exported into this UI. So each of these rows is a different playlist. Actually, some of these are my wife's playlists as well, that I have in my music collection. And see, the idea here is that all of these playlists are playing all of the time. So when you're looking at this UI, you're seeing all of the songs in the different playlists drifting past you. So it isn't that any particular playlist even has a starting point. It's just constantly cycling. And so this will give you an impression of the UI. I'll just pause it for a sec. Before I unpause it, these things move quite slowly because basically they're going past the playhead in the amount of time that it would take for the song to pass the playhead. So if you hit a song, like, I've got some weird stuff in here, like some Muppet stuff from the Muppets movies. And actually, this is a 15-second clip of speech. And so as soon as it hits here, if it's playing, it suddenly shoots by. But you'll see everything is in motion all of the time. And then we're just playing with this idea of being able to very quickly kind of switch between radio stations. So the idea is to create immediacy so that your playlist is always, the songs in your playlist are always available. And you can start to create your playlist as, think of your playlist as personal radio channels that you might switch behind as you see things drift by or as your tastes change during the day. And then once you've got that metaphor, then you can start to play with the UI and start to think of it as a more dynamic thing. So we start to get to a point where we can really kind of throw the playlist around. And so that you start to really get into that kind of idea of serendipity. That this here's a UI where if you get bored, you just flick it and it lands on some random song, and that's the song that you'll hear. And you can flip this UI vertically as well as horizontally. So the idea is to take this construct that's quite fixed for us at the moment and make it a much more dynamic and a much more interesting thing. And you can imagine that, for example, if you did this also for playlists that you subscribe to on sites like Spotify, where that difference between this being personal content, which has its own importance to me. I see a song go by and it's got maybe associations for me for particular times or events or whatever, versus discovering content that maybe you don't know about. This is another project that we did called the Digital Physical Photo Display. So this still has the kind of physical element to it. And what we were doing here was basically trying to make this connection between digital things local and digital things online. So this idea that you might have a photo that you've got on your laptop, and you've posted the same photo to Facebook. Well, if the Facebook one gets lots of comments and likes and favorites, why doesn't the local one also know about that? So even if you see the local one, you get a sense of the activity that was going on online, so that the things you share continue to have some kind of connection between them. So we're interested in that, but then we decided to stretch that back to the physical as well. So this is basically a working prototype that we built that allows you to, that has a little shelf on it. So this is a touch screen here. It has a little digital shelf on it, and you drop physical photos onto it, and the shelf has a whole bunch of reflectance sensors built into it. This is something that David there actually built. He's one of the designers in my team. Everybody can look at David. And you drop a physical photo onto it, and these reflectance sensors along here recognize the pattern of the image at the bottom of the physical photo, and also recognize where that photo is on the shelf. And then it does a whole bunch of UI based on that. So we've got this kind of physical input. Dropping a photo onto the shelf is the physical input. And then this background is a digital touchscreen that we can then do digital things with. So the device here basically has, hang on a second. This at the right point. There we go. So if you imagine this is the physical photo that I printed out. On this device, it knows about the digital version of this photo as well. And so it has that connection between the physical and the digital photo. Somewhere on the hard drive here is the digital version of that photo. And somewhere on the hard drive here as well are the set of photos that were taken at the same time as that physical photo was taken. So what I'm going to show is just a series of kind of little iterations that say, what if you would exploit this physical to digital connection a little bit? So a very simple example is to basically say, I put the physical photo on here. And now what it's doing is it's going off and finding the digital photo, pulling a whole bunch of colors out of the digital photo and using them in the background. So we're just purely using this thing as a digital photo frame, but then the colors are basically a way of providing a beautiful backdrop that's connected to the physical version. And then it's pulling out a little bit of metadata here as well. So that's the first very kind of simple iteration. And we deliberately made it kind of low key. That iteration isn't about doing anything particularly fancy. It's just actually about augmenting the physical version a little bit using digital properties. So the second iteration, basically, you put the physical photo on it, and now it goes off and fetches the range of photos that were taken at the same time as this physical photo. So what you get is this interesting property where you're using the physical photo to key in to the event, but then you're using the digital touch screen to actually walk somebody through the event. So you can imagine this thing might sit in your hallway of your house You have friends visiting and you say, oh yeah, I went to Disney World, or we did this Easter egg hunt, let me tell you about it. And you just have the little stack of one photo from each of the events. You pop one on, it brings up the digital photos from that event, and then you just use the touch screen to walk them through digital content. So that again is another little iteration. So we go from the connection from the physical thing to one file, the connection from the physical thing to multiple files, and then the last version is starting to think a little bit about services online. So what if these physical things connected you to online stuff instead? So in this case, these Easter egg hunt photos were also posted on Flickr. So now it's going and getting the comments and things that were associated with the digital version of these photos online. This shot here was taken at a museum called Crystal Bridges in Arkansas. So what if this photo now connected you with the blog of Crystal Bridges? So it was less about your visit to the place than it was about remaining connected to the place. So this gives you a sense of kind of how the system works, where we're just doing very simple kind of reflexant sensing to pick up the pattern across the bottom of the image. It's just a regular postcard that we printed with a postcard service. And then we're doing some very simple machine learning to basically train the system to say, to show it what this pattern looks like at a range of points along this little strip. So this is another device. This is actually an intern project. So this is kind of an example of what an intern here gets done in 12 weeks. This is a designer who came to us from Umeå, a university which is a design university in Sweden. And he was interested in exploring the idea of taking digital stuff from online and somehow showing it in the context of your home. So at the moment, you know, a lot of the digital stuff you see in your home on different kinds of displays, or if you've even got a digital photo frame, those of you who have one left, you know, it tends to be local content rather than online content. So what he did was literally download all 600 photos that he had on Facebook into this device. And this, again, was a working prototype built on the Gadgeteer platform that some of you may know about that we developed in-house. So the idea here is basically this display shows the oldest photo in Facebook, and then this display there shows the newest photo. And then you can just drag this middle display backwards and forwards, and what you've created is a timeline between the sets of photos. If you want, you can twist these little rotary dials, and what they'll do is basically narrow down to certain points on the timeline. So then what you're looking at might be a particular event or a particular range of events or a particular set of days. And then, as I said, you can move the display. So this gives you a sense of how the system works. So you can rotate this thing to change the extents of the timeline. And then once you've got to a range that you're interested in, then you move the middle thing. And it acts to show you the photos. And the interesting thing about this is that you can also switch to seeing metadata. Because it's Facebook content, you can switch to seeing metadata as well as seeing the photos. So one interesting view on this, I don't know whether he shows it in this video, is that he has a little map that has a point on it where every photo was taken. So you can switch to that map. And as you drag the timeline along, you see these dots move around the world that show you the different places that you traveled. So the third design project type, if you like, is material. So the pragmatic approach is much more about having a very strong context, a very strong need and situation and set of people involved in the project. The material approach is much more about saying, I've got a material, or I've got a technology, or I've got some, some data, for example. I want to exploit it and see what this thing can be used for. So it's less about kind of necessarily finding a use case first and saying what's the design that will fit that. It's the reverse of that, if you like. So you could say, for example, in our building we have lots of different teams generating lots of different approaches to machine learning, for example, to computational science, and a lot of those are engineering orientated. So there's a question for us as a team: if machine learning have built some particular system that does something amazing, what is it actually good for, and how would you play with it, and what are the properties of this system that this person has built in order for new experiences to emerge, if you like. So this is a project that we did here, which when we moved into this building a couple of years ago. So here we are on the end of Tennyson Road and Station Road. And here's Tennyson Road out here. And we were interested, as kind of new inhabitants of this building, if you like, to get involved with the community here and get a sense of what this community is like. And the interesting thing about this street particularly is, you know, we're pretty much the only kind of commercial thing going on this street. Most of the rest of Tennyson Road is residential, and it's a really interesting mix of residential with kind of a little bit more wealthy in the middle around this kind of little patch of grass. At this end, it tends to be a little bit more kind of bed and breakfast houses, a few hotels. At the other end, it tends to be students. So it's an interesting demographic mix, if you like. And at the time, we were interested in getting a little bit more of a sense of concepts around big data. And so big data is a thing that a lot of us talk about, but it's quite nebulous as a concept, and it means different things to different people depending on how you talk to them. And so what we were interested in is just saying, if you go and talk to the average community, what are their attitudes to data? What kind of data is interesting to them? What kind of data might they be able to generate? And what might you then use it for? So it might be about creating relationships through data between two homes on the road, or maybe through a range of homes across the whole community, or maybe from the home back to us, or from the home from us to the home. So this is just an example of kind of a bunch of the different experiments we did around this project. So one of the things we did was, in talking to the community, you know, they had a kind of whole range of concerns. And the interesting thing when you talk to people very specifically about data is a lot of the kind of high level concepts and kind of the ambiguity around what kind of data might be interesting kind of becomes very mundane very, very quickly, because people have very particular concerns in their community. So one of the concerns of this street, for example, is traffic speed. You know, they live near the station. They're forever having taxis rush up and down this road. You know, they're worried about safety, for example. And so that's one of the kinds of data they're interested in, is how do you tell the speed of traffic on this road, as well as other things about the environment, as well as other things that, about what's going on in the community in Cambridge more widely. So one of the things we did for them was mount a motion control up on the roof of the building here and point it down Tennyson Road to just start to get a sense of traffic, if you like. And so this is the result of that. This is a really kind of a low fidelity, what is it? It's like 16 by 16 pixel camera or something, right, David? It's this really low fidelity camera that's commonly used just for telling whether people are coming in or out of shopping centers, for example. And so this is the kind of output that you get from that, some sense of the traffic shooting up and down, and occasionally you see flashes down the side as pedestrians go by. So our goal here was to just start kind of building up material that we might be able to use with the community to exploit in different ways so they could learn more about their street. And maybe, if you like, have the tools to be able to argue their case locally about particular issues that were of concern to them. So this is kind of the metadata that was an output put from that. So that's one of the things we were doing, is kind of building up this resource for data on their behalf. And they were also interested in them as data creators. And so one of the things we built was this device called Bullfrog, which is about this big. And the goal of Bullfrog was to sit in the houses of a bunch of residents on Tennyson Road and to allow us to ask them different questions every day so that they could generate data that they could compare with the rest of the residents on the road, for example. So the nice thing about Bullfrog, it has a very simple interface. It has this slot on the front. And then we gave them a whole bunch of different cards. And so we'd send them a question and it would appear on the little digital screen. And then they'd answer the question by basically pushing in one of these range of cards. You know, so we give them a set of cards that were, you know, 0 to 9, a yes, no, kind of the basics. And then as we asked them different questions that were orientated around different kinds of subjects, we'd push new cards through their door, basically. And I think we deployed, about 50 of these down the road? It's a substantial deployment for us. So again, this getting to grips with kind of building things, getting to grips with 3D printing. This is another thing we built off primarily off the Gadgeteer platform. That issue of kind of what kind of new rapid assembly processes like 3D printing, like laser cutting and so on can do in research is kind of an interesting one for us. We've tended in the past to only do deployments of kind of one or two bespoke things, you know, half the time because we make them out of wood and they're absolutely annoying to make in kind of high quantities. But starting to be able to use some of these tools to start to do much broader numbers of deployments, I think, is interesting. So we basically started to create these stories when we, on behalf of the users, where we were starting to contrast different kinds of data and just look at different kinds of data. One of the things the community was interested in was environmental things about what birds, for example, they'd spot up and down here, as well as weather, maybe the impact of trains coming in at certain times of the day, as well as traffic and other things. So what I'll show you is basically the design output of that. And we were interested in creating a situated display. Now, since we're in Tennyson Road, one of the things we're able to do here is basically use our ground floor as a display to tell people going past about what's going on the street, using this material as the stuff that we could display. So rather than taking an approach which is digital, I mean, you will have noticed we've got screens mounted in the front of the buildings here. People have a tendency to just walk past screens and really not pay a great deal of attention to them. And so our approach here was, if you like high-tech, low-tech. And what we did was built a set of physical charts to present the data back to them. And so I'll show you some video in a second, but these are charts that are basically big disks made out of paper. These bar charts at the front are made by hacking tape measures. But so they have this really kind of low-tech, high-tech. And so the idea of the low-tech is to make them approachable. And even the idea of using bar charts and pie charts rather than kind of complex visualizations that you can tend to see in the data visualization space, again, is all about making the data more approachable. I remember we took some video of this to a data visualization conference that's quite well known, and one of the participants there said, "Oh, so much work for a pie chart." These kinds of representations of data are a little bit frowned upon in the data visualization space because you ought to be able to do something more dynamic and more network looking, or that you can zoom into or zoom out of. But these are still a set of tools that are tremendously accessible to people. And it's their accessibility that kind of made them interesting to us. So I'll show you a shot at the end of the deployment in the streets, but we've got a set of videos that kind of give you a sense of what these things were like in practice. Because these are basically Internet of Things objects. You know, you plug them into the Ethernet, and we have had a service online that was taking all this data that we generated and that we were polling people for, and then pushing. This was one of the outputs. In addition to pushing the data back to people through their little bullfrog devices and online, then we had this thing sitting in the set of charts sitting in the ground floor window here, so people could look at it as they went past. So this is a little e-paper display sitting by it that just flicks through at various points to basically act as the legend for the chart as we need it. And one thing I like about these particularly is that people love looking around the back of these objects as much as they love looking around the front of them, because they're beautifully engineered things. You know, again, built using, built exploiting 3D printing and then engineered in-house. But again, you get this strong sense of kind of the low tech from the front. You just see these discs moving, and then from the back, you get this kind of strong sense of the engineering involved. So again, the bar chart here. So this is, you know, while the pie chart allows us to do kind of proportional representations, then the bar chart allows us to start doing, you know, ranges over time, for example. And we had two layers of those. You can see we were using a bunch of E-ink displays across the bottom as legends on each of the columns. There's a shot here somewhere of the tape measures up close that really shows you. Did I miss it? There we go. So you can see this is another of David's pieces of work. So you've got the tape measure there, and then we've got one of the 3D printers that allows you to do printing from between two materials. And so he basically printed these wheels off that were rubber on the outside, and then kind of the equivalent of ABS on the inside. And this gives you a sense of what the objects were like when they were put in the display right in the in the corner of the building. So the last thing I wanted to mention was communication. And communication for design tends to be seen more almost from a marketing perspective. You do some piece of work, you've got to really advertise it to a bunch of people in order to get a bunch of people enthusiastic and make them really think that you've done something valuable. But I think you need to think of communication as something more fundamental to the design process. A lot of the role of a designer in a multidisciplinary team is to build things that allow groups, when they get back together again, to agree whether the thing that's been built is what they thought of or not. So the sketches and prototypes and you know all kinds of things that designers create are a negotiating and a communication vehicle for teams to work together. A lot of what can happen with teams that don't have design or don't have some kind of ethos of sketching involved in them is that you stay with words. And words remain abstract and remain high level and don't get specific. So you'll have a bunch of people sitting in the room all thinking they're using the same words for the same purpose, but actually the words mean slightly different things to different people. And they'll get a long way down the path of thinking they're building something. And then when they see something that they've deeply invested in and they look at it, it's not what all of them expected. Now, if earlier on you start to show visual things as communication tools to that group as a whole, then you can start working out. You both allow everybody to agree, oh, this is what we're talking about, or disagree and say, oh, I didn't expect this, I expected this. But also those visual things you show to the team, they act as a springboard to allow you to have more ideas. That actually, in order to be imaginative, often being specific, you know, and seeing a literal sketch of something is the thing that releases your imagination. You don't have to stay vague, if you like, to be imaginative. And so a lot of what we produce as designers plays that role of communicating within a team. And then if you're lucky, some of those pieces of work that you're doing anyway as a member of the team also act to be strong external communication pieces. So I was going to show you an example of that. So we did a project that was looking at the potential role of a device like Connect at the desktop. So we're wondering whether Connect could basically be used in the context of knowledge work. So if you're doing day-to-day things, not with a tablet, not with the Xbox, but literally at your desktop, what might you use gestures and things that Connect could sense for? And so this is a video that was done very, very early. This is before really we'd built any technology. And the goal here was to just start exploring different kinds of gestures that we might use and how they might be used in the context of everyday office tools, if you like. So this video here, we did a range of these videos. This video here was interested in looking at what you might just do using the palms of your hands as points onto which things might be attached. So here we've basically got the Word document here. You've got an overhead shot of my hands here, and I'm going to do a bunch of different gestures, and then Word is going to respond appropriately. So the first gesture I do is I'm about to scroll. I flick my hand over. I start scrolling, and my hand now represents the point on the document where I started the scrolling from. So I look at some point later on in the document. Then when I've read it, I release my hand, and the Word document points to the point that it was at. So that's one idea. Another idea here that's common is somebody will be writing a Word document, but it's based on another Word document. Maybe somebody else has written it, or it's a piece of reference material. And so the idea here is that your hand acts as a proxy for the second document. Every time you flick your hand over, it pulls the second document to the foreground so you can keep on referring to it when you need to. This is a similar idea here, but the document itself is kind of off stage, and you're getting a more direct control between the palm of your hand and that secondary document. And then what I've done there is a little gesture called pinning. So you bring the second document in. Actually, I want to keep the second document. I pin it. I do some work on it. And then when I'm done, I unpin it and throw the document away, or put it to the side. So the interesting thing about this video is basically, like the one I showed earlier on about assessment, so this is using two hands to basically tile documents parallel to one another. Like the video that I showed earlier on with the SSMS system, this was done before we built anything. So I videoed my hands first, and then in After Effects, I reassembled the different parts of Word. So I made a long document, if you like, cut out all of the frames of Word, stuck them into After Effects using Photoshop, and then just did some animation of the thing scrolling up and down when I needed to. And then I just timed the Word document to match what my gestures were doing. So what you're doing there is basically trying to set up a level that you're wanting the group to attain. So you're basically saying, are these the kinds of experiences that you want us to be able to, that we want the technology to be able to achieve? Is this the kind of bar we want to set ourselves in terms of achieving that? And what you get is something, in the case of this project, that the group could really kind of gel around and say, oh yeah, these are the kinds of, this is what we're after in terms of the simplicity, the timing, and all of these things as well. And this particular video has been really useful to us because it's also acted externally to be able to tell people what this project is all about. Because once you show the video, it becomes relatively self-explanatory, kind of what your goals are. So that goal of using communication as a vehicle internally to gel a team to say this is what we're after, this is the kind of feel we're after, and then hopefully be able to use the same material externally to get people to buy into your project is really valuable. And the other thing we do is, you know, a lot of our output, like I'm sure a lot of yours, is basically 10-page text-heavy conference papers, you know. And so if we're trying to impact an internal product development team, you know, I've never seen a conference paper sitting on a product a team member's desk. You know, these things are too dense and they take too much work to really get the value out of. And so one thing we do that is kind of explicit piece of communication is try and synthesize a lot of the concepts that we're getting just down to the key insights that we've got around a particular domain. So some of the work I showed you earlier about the reasons people keep some things and throw other things away, why people organize things a certain way, the choices people make about what they put on display in the home and what they don't, and all of those kinds of things. For us, they're about a particular domain of research, but for a team that does the Windows File Explorer or does OneDrive or a system that's about managing and organizing digital things, it provides a way for them to look at their project from a direction that maybe they wouldn't have taken before. So one of the things we do is produce this set of magazines. So there's some copies, I think, out there, some copies maybe in the rack out by the security desk as well. And our goal here is to create these kind of communication pieces that really synthesize all of our learnings down to some particular topic. And I think this ends up being effort that we all kind of have to put in, basically saying sometimes you have to really, you really have to find kind of pithy approaches to really pulling out what's key. And often it means jettisoning a lot of stuff you think, oh, I really wish I wasn't going to lose that because that's where the value is for me. But for the person that you're presenting this to, certain things really kind of matter. So you know, this is an issue that we did around human-to-human communication. So we had a whole bunch of observations we'd made in there about the role of identity and the purpose of identity in people's lives. So that idea of just pulling out this is a two-page spread, just pulling out one small observation and hoping that the product team members will read that and maybe it'll excite some ideas about their product that they might not have had before is sort of our goal in producing these magazines. So if you have a chance, have a look at them when they're out. And I've got the URLs there if you're interested. So that's everything I've got. Hopefully that'll give you kind of a sense within the human experience and design team anyway of kind of the role of design as well as sort of the range of work that we do. And I think we've got 8 minutes for questions. Thanks. Oops. I think that people's expectations in both digital and physical things when it comes to technological stuff is higher than it was before, you know. So you might say, because I'm interpreting craftsmanship there as being a deep care about the quality of the thing that you produce, you know. And I think the general public's expectations of the quality of the experiences they get digitally and physically now in technological objects is way higher than it was 10 years ago. I mean, I think there's so I think it matters more than it did. I think there's an interesting question about how much it matters in research. You know, so a lot of the goal with a lot of our prototypes was not to produce product-like things. It was basically to say we have some area of interest in research, maybe about people's relationships to the artifacts in their lives. Let's do some field research and then build things that, again, we can take back to them to get them to think about their stuff in more interesting ways. You know, so backup box, we took back out in the field with the other objects that we built. We put them on a table And we got people whose homes we were visiting to also get out kind of photos and heirlooms and things that were precious to them, and put them with our objects in order to be able to have a conversation that kind of contrasted these digital things we built with the physical things that they had. There, you know, I think that to some extent the HCI community has got away with not having to worry about craft in the past. You know, I come from a weird background where I've both gone to Chi a lot. But I came from the Royal College of Art, where their expectation in terms of design is very high, and I'd argue that the kinds of artifacts that have typically arrived at Chi in the past, from a craft perspective, haven't been as high quality as you would expect in a creative design environment like the RCA, or to some extent you'd expect in a product orientated environment. It's sort of up to you whether that matters or not. I think there's a tremendous amount of value in artifacts that are low fidelity and are deliberately a little bit crappy, because when you go and show something that's really highly finished, you need to be prepared to have a conversation with somebody with that highly finished context in mind, as if this your goal there is to create the illusion that this is a real thing, and the closer you get to that illusion, the more craft matters, I think. But your goal might be to get an honest kind of feedback that's different from that. And people can tend to be more honest about the kind of general nature of what you're researching if they don't see your thing and think, oh, you've clearly spent hours on that. You know, there's no way I'm saying anything that might remotely insult this object that you've made. You know, that people's levels of, not honesty, but their politeness shifts, you know, if they feel like you've put a lot of effort into stuff versus not. So, you know, we can get as much value, but in a different way, in research artifacts that are deliberately sketchy, that are made from paper, that are clearly unfinished, you know, that are sitting in off the shelf plastic boxes. It's a different kind of feedback that you'll get. But when you're when it's coming to creating, to comparing yourself to the illusion of a product, then I think craft increasingly matters.
That sounds very much like design thinking, or the design thinking approach. So do you use Microsoft here, or do you not?
I can't decide whether. Well, I think that there's an issue in design about method. You know, so if you talk to Tony Dunn, who was the Royal College of Art professor until recently, you know, he would argue basically every time he does a design project, he uses a different design method. He makes up the method as he goes along. So, and I think that's the way designers tend to work. They build some artifact and they think, actually, based on this, here's a bunch of new ideas. We need different strategies in order to think how to build those things and get feedback on them. And so I think designers tend to think of method as being quite a fluid thing. So I tend to get edgy as a designer when I start to read papers in which design method starts to become quite a fixed thing, you know, and then there's a lot of literature in the Chi space about the use of cultural probes. You know, that cultural probes came out from. Does everybody know what cultural probes are? Probably, cultural probes are basically they've ended up being a method in the HCI community where you will have some particular set of people you're interested in researching around, and through the mail you send them a package that's just full of activities to do. So you might send them, a typical one is to send them a disposable camera and a list of, often a strange list of things for them to take shots of in their home. You know, take a shot of something you love. Take a shot of something that's green. And a lot of the cultural probe deliberately kind of like creates kind of an ambiguous set of questions and activities in order to stir up some things in a household that maybe is a little bit sort of unexpected. And so and basically, that cultural probes were an approach developed by Bill Gaver and Tony Dunn. Bill Gaver's a kind of well known in the HCI community at Goldsmiths for one particular project. And basically, they were funded by the European Union to do this project. And one of the requirements of the funding was that they developed a method. And so they developed cultural probes. But when you talk to Tony, he'd basically say, if I did that project again, it would be a different method. But it's a method that's become quite systematized within the HCI community and even within the design community, so to a certain extent. So I guess I'd say that there's this process of kind of expansion, of opening your options, of sketching, of using low fidelity approaches to really explore before you make investment technologically, and then that process of kind of iteration of narrowing down your options. I think that's generally speaking, the design process. You know, and I found that generally speaking, that process is the same whether I work in product development or whether I work in research. It's just in research, my goal is much more connected to the research hypothesis than it is making it on the shelf, you know, and being something that somebody is going to pay for day to day. Yeah. Go ahead. I don't think we have any. Well, we don't have. I guess the way that I see it is that we are, all of our projects are multidisciplinary, in that they have design, they have engineering, and they have social science. And during the project, different disciplines take the lead. So sometimes your project might be more focused on field work, on talking to people, and understanding some domain, some set of problems. And often during that process, the social scientist will take the lead on the project, while the designer might start responding a bit to what you've got from the field work, maybe looking at other artifacts that are out there, you know. And so the role that's in the lead can often shift. But I don't think we really have any projects that don't have design involved, you know. I mean, all the things we make are inherently human facing. So we don't engineer things that are back end and don't have some kind of human interaction associated with them. So I guess we define that for ourselves because we always pick projects that are about some kind of human relationship to technology. And for us that instinctively means you need to have people who have an expertise both in talking to real people and understanding real problem domains, as well as people who understand how to synthesize something so that it feels like it can be approached and used by a person. Any other questions? Yeah, go ahead.
How much are you connected to the other four research groups at Microsoft? Do you have meetings with researchers in those groups?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So I think I've done projects with all four other groups. So we're increasingly doing work in the area of machine learning, looking at particularly in this building computational vision, and ways that you might explore and exploit that. You know, I think people's lives are increasingly being filled with systems that learn, and there are a lot of problematic elements to that. You know, how do you know when a system that's learning has come up with something new? How do you know what it's based its learning on? How do you know what you did that affected the decisions that it made? A lot of those issues are really HCI and human orientated issues. That impact a great deal whether the technology, particularly in a human context, will be acceptable, you know, and so when you start to talk about concepts around AI with machine learning, for example, some people find some of that problematic from a human perspective, and some people don't, you know. So that's a whole interesting area to kind of engage with. And the same with computational science. We've done work with them looking at data visualization around environmental data and building kind of very accessible experiences around that. So, yeah, I think we're also getting better at that. It's kind of a two-way thing. I think us as a team are getting better at that, and I think also other teams in the building are starting to get pushed a little bit more to think about the human-facing side of what they're doing as well. That you could argue that it's that we've left it to product groups, if you like, to understand what it is that we've made and we've researched and understand how to exploit that. And I think as a research organization, we have to do more of the work there to translate the things that we make technologically, so product groups can look at it and think, oh, okay, I have a better understanding of how a person might use this thing. So I think more of that onus is sort of on us. I think we're out of time, so thank you very much for your time. Sorry, we're over. Thanks.
Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.